you. Didn't expect that. Thank you very much. That's good. You're so sweet. Thank you. Thank you. You may be seated. That's nice. Melanie and I have been away for about 4 weeks, and I was testing your faith to see if you could keep the weather warm, but I see you failed the test. Many of you didn't show up for Friday morning prayer, I could tell. It got real cold. But I'm back, and notice I brought warm weather back, and I'm going to keep it warm and keep the snow. People make fun of that all the time, but I believe you can control the weather. So, good weather. But we needed a few days of cold to kill all the germs, and that's done. That's done. And on we go. Saturday, I'll be here for rehearsals. Tomorrow night, I'll be here for rehearsals. I want you to pray. This is a special prayer request tomorrow at 1 o'clock. There's about 80 pastors that are going to meet here. And these 80 pastors are in the Chicagoland area, in Michigan, and Wisconsin. And pray for us from 1 to 6. We are ministering to those pastors. And it is on the issue of Israel and where we stand with Israel and what is happening with Israel. And it's going to be, how many be praying tomorrow? Just put up a prayer. Just say, Lord, bless that meeting. Bless that pastor's meeting tomorrow from 1 to 6. Then there's rehearsal, and I'll be here Saturday for rehearsal. And then Sunday, I have an incredible message. I cannot wait to speak it, and it will be very unique. Get as many people as you can. And tell everyone about Jesus of Nazareth. I noticed that it wasn't as exciting to you when you saw the commercial. But let me tell you, we should be more excited about Jesus' story than Super Bowl or how many thinks that story is great? Jesus is great. I want to talk about just for a few moments here tonight, moments of moaning. Moments of moaning. What I mean by that is we all go through moments in which we moan. And the reason why we moan is because something has hit our lives that we can't even talk about it. All we can do is moan. You ever been there? Might be there now, but you ever been in that moment where there were not words to describe how you felt or what the situation was? Something your children, something in your marriage, something of a bill or something that came in the mail. Exasperated until you couldn't cry, you couldn't laugh, you couldn't say anything negative, you couldn't say anything positive. All you could do was moan, groan about, oh no, I lost this battle. This is horrible, and this court procedure, and what's going on in my life? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody? If you don't know what I'm talking about, you're an angel, and we welcome you because the Bible says we welcome angels unaware. So for you that don't say anything, welcome angels. God bless you. We're delighted you're here. But for the rest of us that are humans, we have been through some stuff. Turn to somebody and say, I've been through some stuff, if they're near you. And I want to encourage everybody. I know it's Valentine's Day, 2 weeks from tonight. On the 14th is also Ash Wednesday. But I want to tell you that you can take your date on Friday night, and it'll be half as cheap, because if you go out on the 14th, they double the prices. And there won't be no double price here Wednesday night. Plus, you're going to be anointed, given a nail. The cross comes down. You're going to be given the special cloth. And let me tell you, the next 50 days is going to be the best 50 days of your life if you will honor Ash Wednesday. It's a good thing. So get the word out, Ash Wednesday. I want to read a scripture verse about moaning and groaning. I want to start in the book of Romans, and I want to call your attention to the 24th verse of the 8th chapter of Romans. This chapter happens to be one of my favorites. It's marked up. Notes are taken by it. I always love to go to the 8th chapter of Romans. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what man seeth, why doth he yet hope for?
In the 25th verse, it says, but if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. You have not seen your victory. You have not seen the evidence yet of what you've been praying for. But with patience and hoping, it's going to come to pass. The Bible teaches us in Hebrews 11:1, faith is the substance of things hoped for. There is nothing wrong in holding on to your hope and saying, I'm hoping and believing I will be out of debt. I am hoping and believing I will leave an inheritance to my children. Did you know it says that in the Bible? Do you know it says that you should leave an inheritance to your children's and their children? Most people we bury nowadays cannot even afford their burial. They have not prepared. God wants to bless you that when you pass, that your children will be blessed, and then when they have children, they will be blessed by the money that you have, that you were blessed with, that when God blessed you when you were on this earth. This is the will of God. This is a very scriptural purpose. So don't lose your hope for your children, for your marriage, for your health, for your life, for your business, for your vision. Do not lose your hope. Now, if you can already see it, it's not hope. But if you can't see it, you can hope. You keep hope alive. You keep that alive within your spirit. Now, Paul is talking about that. And then he goes into that moment in which it doesn't come quick enough. The money doesn't come quick enough. The straightening of that child does not come quick enough. Something has happened to a relationship in your life and it's not fixed quick enough. The loss of job, the behind of bills, the bankruptcy, the falling short of failure in keeping up with the job you had that supported it, and now it doesn't, and crisis has come, and depression sets in, and one sits in a lonely spot, and the groaning, the moaning starts taking place. Every person goes through that, including Jesus. The moaning, the groaning, the moment in which, where do I go? How do I fix this? Can it be fixed? I made a mistake, and it looks like everyone is against me. Everyone has exposed me. And how will I get to the next level? How will I be able to get beyond the hope of what my doctor has said about my body? My body, he says, is not functioning, and my liver or my blood or my stomach or my heart or my veins or my muscles. And so the disease of what they say and call arthritis and other diseases and sicknesses that begin to form in our body, that hope that I can move my hands again, walk again, that I can move beyond this condition that I'm in, hope. But then all of a sudden, there is that moment in which the groaning and the moaning takes over. You can't talk to anybody, don't want to talk to anybody, don't care what anybody else has to say. You just want to turn to moaning. Anybody know what I'm talking about? It may not be good to be alone. It may not be good to be in that car alone. It may be good for you to be around someone or to help you through this time. But there's a moment in everyone's life, even with your mate sleeping in the same bed with you, and they're sound asleep, but you're awake on your pillow, and the tears are running, and they're running on either side of your head, and you're biting your bottom lip, hoping that your partner will not be able to hear having to get up and go somewhere and can't say a word. You just groan and you moan and you say, this is a moment of moaning. Paul then refers to this after he tells us about hope and not to lose it. He goes on to say in the 26th verse, likewise the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. That's a good word right there. He clearly, distinctly tells you the Spirit is going to help you when you go through some kind of infirmity. Whatever you go through, the Spirit is equipped to help you through that infirmity. A preacher may not be able to help you. The church may not be able to help you. Your friend, your wife, your husband, your children, your favorite evangelist, somebody on television. They can't help you, but the Spirit has already declared that when you get to a moment of moaning and groaning and you don't know what to do in this marriage, the Spirit, hallelujah, has declared, I am in you for that purpose. And that purpose is, I will help you when you are in that infirmity. Now that's a good place to say amen. For you that are not used to saying amen, that's a perfect place to say amen. When you say amen, you're saying, so be it, God. So be it, Spirit. And then it goes on and says, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. Now let me tell you, you will get to a place, doesn't matter how spiritual you are, it don't matter how many times you've been to church, how many years you've been in the kingdom, your position is hospital ministry or being on stage, Jesus of Nazareth, or being an elder, or being something in the church, doing something. Let me just tell you, there's going to be times you don't know how or what to pray. It is a moaning moment in which all you can do is moan. I'm not talking about complaining. I'm not talking about being negative. I'm just talking about neutral territory, on moaning to the place that you're not negative, you're not positive, you're just in a place of, I don't know what to say. But the Spirit of God that you invited in your life has already equipped and said, I'll help you in your infirmities. And when you don't even know how to pray, I'll take over. You didn't get that. I'll take over. And I will go into a place of intercession. I will take the place while you're groaning and moaning and don't know what to pray and don't know what to say, and I will move into position. You're not excited yet, let me tell you. Then you need to get to a place where you moan and groan, and then you'll understand the terminology of what Apostle Paul is saying here. And the fact is that you all, everybody, doesn't matter who you are, including Jesus, will get to the place that you can't even do nothing but moan. But that's when the Spirit of God comes in to say, I'm going to help you in this infirmity. You lost your job, I'm going to make sure you get a better job. You lost on this situation, but it's going to be better. If Walt Disney went bankrupt 11 times, it don't matter how many times you've gone bankrupt. I'm a God that can deliver you out of bankruptcy. They took your house away, but I intend to give you a better one. And that situation that happened to you, I intend for it. Why? How can you say that? That's the reason why it says to hold on to hope. Even though when you don't know how to pray, the Spirit maketh intercession. It becomes your prosecutor. It becomes the mediator. It becomes your spokesman. It becomes your lawyer. It becomes your judge. It becomes your jury. And it begins to look for something and it's not looking for your prayer because you've already got to a place you don't know what to pray for. So the Spirit's not looking at you to pray the right prayer. It's just looking for you to say, do you still hope? And you got to shout, I do hope, somebody shout. I do hope, somebody. I do hope, somebody. I do hope. And you see people, your friends pass you up and you say, it seems like they always get a break. Let me teach you about breaks. The only way you get to the top is you got to have a break. I'm not talking about a break of the silver spoon in your mouth. I'm talking about Jacob fighting the angel and saying, I'm not going to let you go till you give me a blessing. And the angel smote him on his side and he blessed him, but the rest of his life, he walked with a limp. Look at me. I may have been bankrupt in the past. I may have been divorced. I may have made a mistake. I may be on drugs. I slipped and fell down, but I may be walking with a limp. But blessed be to God, I got my blessing because I hoped. And in the moment of my moaning, in the moment, the Spirit shifted gears and said, don't worry about a thing. I'm going to help you in this infirmity. You hang on to hope. I'm going to get you out of this situation. I am personally going to visit the throne of God, because the only way you can get to the throne of God, if you read the word correctly, is we must come boldly before the throne of grace and mercy. The throne of God is full of grace and mercy, because he says, if you boldly come to the throne of grace, you will obtain mercy in the time of need. And there's nothing like the intercessor of the Spirit moving to the throne saying, I need help for Bill. I need help for Sue. I need help for Brother George. It's time for you to go into action, God, and open up the Red Sea and shut the mouths of the lions and let not the fire burn them in the fiery furnace. Need a good amen on Wednesday night somewhere, somehow. And if you don't hurry up and say amen, I'm going to fax me a couple through Amazon to get it here quicker. Because if you've not ever been through a moaning moment, you will be someday. But hold on to hope. Because the fact is the Spirit maketh intercession. If we read a little more, it'll talk about that moaning and groaning. And it says that the Spirit will make an intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. I like the next verse. When you don't know how it's going to turn out, he tells you how it's going to turn out. Because this is what the Spirit does, and this is what the intercession of the Spirit does. For the next verse says, we know that all things work out for the good to them that love God. That means you don't have to be perfect. If you love God, you are in position for everything to work out for the good. Do I have anybody in the house and watching me that loves God? Can you say something out loud to God? I love you. Thank you, God. You're incredible. I love God. Take a look at that 28th verse. And we know all things will work out together for the good, because you behaved right. You did no sin. You were perfect. We know that all things work out together for the good because you were so holy and you were so great. All you need to do is say, I love God when I'm in the valley. I love God when I'm on the mountaintop. I love God when I'm going through hell, and I love God on my way to heaven. I love God regardless of what the weather is. I love God regardless of what the season is. Can I get anybody to open up and just tell God, I love you, I love you, I love you. Clap your hands and make a joyful noise and declare, I love God. Now, the last part of that scripture verse is more encouraging because you didn't save yourself. In fact, until the Spirit came after you, because the Bible says no man can come to the Father unless the Spirit draws him. And the only reason why you got the Spirit, or the only reason why you're saved, is because he went after you. Meaning, you were called according to his purpose. He wanted your trouble. He wanted your mistakes. He wanted your lies. He wanted your hypocrisy. He wanted all of your junk. But oh, praise be to God. He says it's going to work out, for I've called you according to my purpose. That means whatever you're going through now, whatever thing, anything you've gone through in the past, and whatever you're going through in the future, this is the hope. It will all work out. May I give everybody here tonight a rear view mirror, just for a moment. Just for a moment. When I give it to you, I'm going to expect you, after you look at it just for a moment, to throw it out the window. Quit looking in rearview mirrors. But I'm going to give you a rearview mirror. You got about 30 seconds to look at it. And aren't you already saying, look what the Lord has done. Look how far he's brought me. I didn't think I was going to make it out of that doctor's office alive. I didn't know the bank was going to do what it did. But look at me now. If they could just see me now. My enemies tried to destroy me, talked about me, put me down, and said I wouldn't make it, that it was done, it was over with. But look at me now. What you need to know, I was called according to his purpose. And greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And in my moments of mourning, moaning, something happens. Apostle Paul says these words. At first, they're frightening words. At first, they're words that you say, that's crazy. At first, when you read these words, you say, there's no way I will ever reach that level of what Paul is saying in the scriptures. When he says, I rejoice in my infirmity. Now, many people say, Pastor Steve, have you reached that point? Not quite, but I'm getting there. But there have been times in my life, it's the truth, when I had everything against me and I was in the moment of mourning. And I started jumping up and down in my office. I didn't have music. I didn't have a singer. I didn't have a drum player. I didn't have a guitar player. I had no surround sound. It was just me in my mourning. And all of a sudden, the Spirit of God whispered and said, everything's going to be all right. And I begin to jump up and down in my infirmity. Yeah. I know, you're not there either. And she's like, you sat there. I said, no, I'm not there. And Paul says, I learned to rejoice in my infirmity. Same chapter talks about, not only did I learn to rejoice in my infirmity, but what I was going through was temporary. Lord, it's been a long time. Look at your watch, God. Look at your watch. Look how long. God looks at you and says, no man has seen God at any time. I don't live in a clock, in a watch, in a timetable. You groaned in your moment, in your season, but me, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I just want you to know, you can't put me in a time zone. The only two people in the time zone is you and the devil. You and the devil are in the time zone. We're in the time zone. Now, he's pretty mad. The Bible says, did you know why he's mad? He's not mad because you came to church, you give your tithing, you come to prayer meetings, you're in Jesus of Nazareth, you're doing everything that God wants you to do. He's not mad because of that. The Bible tells you why he's mad. He's mad and full of wrath. Because his time is short. Short. Don't have much time. I'm headed for hell. I don't have much time. And God says, I don't live in a time zone. I'm the first and the last. I am eternity. You and I live in a time zone. And only those that are over 50 can say this. It's going by pretty fast. When you get 60, you start hating the clock. Stop. I hate you, clock. When you're 16, it don't move fast enough. But when you get to 60, stop. I hate that clock. When you get 70 and 80, I don't like time. When Satan, before he was kicked out of the heavenlies, you read this in the 14th chapter of Isaiah, the big war that happened, a third of the heavens was influenced by Lucifer. He convinced a third of God's angels to follow him. He sold himself. They believed him. The rebellion broke out. He actually said, you can read it in the book of Job, and you can read it in scriptures where the Bible says, I will exalt my throne above him. I will be bigger than God. People who don't go to church, don't give their tithes, don't read the Bible, have the same spirit. I am God. I make all the decisions about my money and my time and my life. And if church gets in the way, it can move out of the way. That's the attitude of Lucifer. I don't need God. I don't need authority. He never dreamed. Even when God said, you shouldn't have done what you did. I'm going to create a hell for you. And anybody that follows you, you cross that threshold, it's over. There's no recall. I don't want a recall. You ever talk to a good backslider? I'm not going to church. You ever talk to a good backslider? Too many hypocrites. They're just announcing they are a hypocrite. They were a hypocrite when they were there. They faked it till they could make it. Then when they couldn't make it, they went on their own. No God, no submission, no loving one another. Do you know you can't love people in the world until you first love people in the church. The Bible talks about submitting to one another. That's the reason why God's got us all together. You light brown people. You darker black people. You light people. And you real white people. He puts us together to see if we can love each other in the church. Because if you can't, oh, did I hear Jesus say it? You will know that they are my disciples because they have love for one another. And the reason why people don't want to come to church is because they don't want to submit to loving somebody else. And the fact is, the spirit of demons have gotten to them. And there's no recall, but abomination upon their life, because they turned themselves into a god. Your money will rot, your house will rot, and everything you have will turn to rust and will turn to moth. And before you die, you will beg God when you could have had God. But you stepped over the line thinking you could manipulate and become a witch and manipulate God. And Satan says, I don't care. Well, you better care, because you're going to burn. Your wings are going to burn. Your pipes and your being that I created for you to be one of the best singers and worship leaders. Remember, he was the worship leader of heaven. Remember that, Leon? Where are you, Leon? Worship people. Worship people. Remember that. Be careful, worship people. You get an arrogant spirit. Don't tell me what to do. I'm close to the presence of God. I'm closer than anybody else. But you may be closer in the presence of God the way you worship. But worship does not save you. Worship does not redeem you. If that was the case, then why did Satan get into the meeting in the book of Job when God met with the sons of God and Satan had already been cast out? What gave him the right to come to that meeting with the sons of God? He knew how to worship. Everybody needs to get ready. Everybody needs to know this. The devil worships with us. Remember when Jesus got out of the boat? Remember when he got out of the boat? Remember when that demon-possessed man came? Remember the Bible said that demon-possessed man came and worshiped him. And Jesus just stood there and said, yes, go on, do it. Then Jesus cast the demons out of him. The tares and the wheat are among us. The goats and the lambs are among us. There are professionals among us. Hypocrites among us. And they usually sometimes can out-worship a good worshiper. But that's all right. God will even show up for a demonized worshiper. Did I just blow your mind? Well, I thought you had to be holy to worship. Oh, no, 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 no. How do you think God gets there? How do you think God comes into the scene? When two or three are gathered in my name, you begin to worship. He'll just show up. It don't matter if it's a bunch of mavericks that's never gotten saved and they just start saying Jesus right on the Oscar stage. God will show up. Don't you ever judge anybody by worship. Oh, they're spiritual. They know how to worship. Oh, they really know how to do it. They're anointed. So are you. The only problem is you're staring, judging everybody who is and who isn't. But if you would participate, even though you're demon-possessed, you could have God come in. And if you get him close enough, he'll rebuke the devil out of you.
Oh, I wish I could have somebody here and follow my trail of thought. Because the only way that Satan got into that meeting that was privately called in the book of Job was he could worship. And he was good at it. In fact, he don't even care if you worship good. He don't care. No, sir. In fact, he sits on the back row and says, shout, cry, weep, hoop, hack, hoo, yeah. You have to do it all. Go and feel the power of God. And we do. And we enjoy it. And it's precious. And it's wonderful.
But you let the offering time come on. That's when he gets up. You can go on and worship. You keep your money in your pocket. Because worship is not a weapon that destroys me. It's your money. For the Bible says that when you give your tithes and your offering, it is a weapon in God's hand to rebuke the devourer and to play games and to think that your worship rebukes the devil. You're out of your mind. The only time the devil gets up and serves, you ever notice it? Teresa, she's a good worshiper. She's great. And she's full of God, by the way. She, all of these are. None of these are bad people. Teresa will be singing something, you know. Going up yonder, and she'll be going, ah! And everybody else will go, ah, with her. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. Then Pastor Terry steps up, we're going to take an offering. Everybody just dies. You ever notice that? You know why that is? The devil gets up at two places in the service. Offering time and altar call time. Because the only way you can give to God is that God moves upon your heart. Because music and organs and pianos and drums and guitars and songs can move your emotions, but it does not move your heart. But when you obey the word of God and you declare, I'm going to be obedient, and you reach in and you are obedient to God, you put a weapon in God's hand.
That's about half of you. Don't you all pay your tithes? Hey, what are you coming here for? Somebody shout amen. For the Bible says that if you give your tithes an offering, he will rebuke the devourer. And the Bible said he'll take the curse off of your life. And the only reason why you don't pay your tithes is because you're a god to yourself, holding on to the spirit of mammon. You're a hypocrite. You're a professional. It's all right. Because God didn't call me to separate you. And I don't know who you are unless I look at the tithing report, and I don't. So I can preach this way. So you don't think I'm preaching to you. And you are obedient to God. That's when he gets up and says, shut up. Sit down. You're in debt. You can't afford it. Put that credit card up. Shut up. Sit down. Sit down. Shut your mouth. You ever notice how hard it is to take an offering? Come on, folks, let's give. Can't find the phone. Where's the phone? Where's the phone? We got it so down pat now, people actually think you're giving by phone. You can actually fake people out. When you're supposed to be giving, you're on your Instagram. Nobody knows the difference. Put my phone, touch the offering bucket. You're a professional. You're a gamer. God bless you. Keep coming. Keep coming. Because it's not my job to separate the goats and the sheep. It's not my job to separate the tares and the wheat. It's not my job to separate the hypocrites from the non-hypocrites. We can all worship together.
But don't you dare be critical of the person that's sitting on your row when in a couple months they come up with a brand new car and your tailpipe is still dragging. And you look at them and say, "Where'd you get that?" You can't believe what the Lord did. Oh, man, I just got thankful to God, and I don't know what God did, but something opened up and it began to pour out, and I'm telling you, I got this, I got this, I got this, I got this. And then you know the demon-possessed people, because they get jealous. Is that real Gucci or is that fake Gucci? Because if you understood the obedience and understood Satan, for the Bible says, be not ignorant of his devices. When it came offering time, you'd be the first on your feet. Say, I'm going to let the devil know that I'm going to put a weapon in God's hand, and he will be rebuked off of my business, off of my children, off of my health, off of my life. Can I get a big amen somewhere? So I want to talk to the demon-possessed person who is a professional hypocrite that don't like me to say anything about tithing. Just want to tell whoever you are, because I ain't afraid of the devil in you, nor am I afraid of that spirit. That spirit has pushed the preacher to a side. Churches, preachers, big churches, small churches, are afraid to talk about the offering and put a box out in the vestibule hoping people will give, because his board will fire him next week because they said, you talk too much about money. That's a fact. You hear me? The highest level of anointing is the anointing to move hearts for salvation and to give. For where your treasure is, that is where your heart is. And if you don't have a man of God that's flat-footed, that's not afraid of the devil, he'll be a coward, he'll be a sissy, he will wear women's underwear under his suit. We don't have $100 lines. We don't have $1,000 lines. We don't do none of that junk. And if they do that, and that's the way they get it, that's fine. We don't beg anybody. And Sige, your tithing, even if it was $1,000 a week or $2,000, will not match the $85,000 note, nor the $30,000 light bill, nor the other $30,000 insurance. You want me to keep going here? Toilet paper. Won't even match it unless you give $1 million, and then we'd have to adjust the dialogue a little bit and say, yeah, that's but the only people that do that are people who understand the principle that the anointing touched their heart. And don't you ever forget it, the devil walked up to them too and said, don't you give a dime, give it to the March of Dimes, give it to political figures, give it to this one, but don't give it to the church. And then you have the whereabouts to say, shove it up his nose. Jump to your feet with excitement. Because God loves a but you can't be a cheerful giver if you don't know how God does it and will do. Don't be afraid. Next time the offering bucket comes by or your phone, you're going to give, say, you know why you're doing that? Because the devil's saying, no, 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 no. Then he goes to the next one, goes to the next one. And I'm not talking about being a professional person to give, because in the $30 and the $500 a year, building this church, had no rich people. After we build it, They show up. Rick shows up. He's rich. Cynthia's rich, or gonna get rich. Dave is rich, not with a castle, but we went to the hospital with a heart condition and was supposed to die. And Dave, how old are you? How old are you? 83, should die. Should die. You're 83, goodbye, go to heaven. Sandy, you're gonna be a widow. This man pays his tithes. He's never missed. Oh, it won't impress you what he gives, but it impresses God. And when God walked into the surgery room, he walked in with a weapon and said, get the hell out of here, devil. He will be healed. He's alive tonight, 83. He and Sandy. And all of his kids. All of his kids are great. I'm almost done here. Satan said to God, just send me to hell. Just go and send me to hell. Send my third that I got from you. I stole them from you. I'm pretty good at what I got. Yeah, you are. Gabriel and Michael, it's time, God, that we cast him out, right? No, not yet. Michael, go to the room of time. Get a wristwatch called eternity, built into a time zone. It's on the counter. It's a Rolex. Bring it to me. Michael hands God a timepiece. Said, hold him down. Gabriel, Michael, hold him down. And as God got closer to Lucifer before he was cast out of the heavens, he put a watch on him. And he's not even mad because he's going to burn in hell. He's mad because his time is short. That's the reason why you go through hell the first part of your life. Because he knows you don't have much time either. The difference is, he gets to have extended generational time and beat you. And he used to club people. Lucifer used to club people, walk up to people, take death, who he had power of, just shove it into him, die. Die! Die! He walked around with the keys of death like he owned the whole world. But one day while he was drinking Jack Daniels or whatever he was drinking, having a party because the man on Calvary, the prophet had died on the cross, and all of his angels were dancing and having a party and hip-hopping and having all kinds of music and F this and X that and all of that dirty, filthy rot. Jesus walks into the party. Walks right up to the throne of Satan. Satan says, take that mask off, whoever you are. You look like Jesus. I killed him at the cross. Take that mask off. Turn the music up. Give us a little more F. Give us a little more S. Get your vulgarity. Come on, angels. Display the lesbian and homosexual and abortion. Scream it out. We are the winners. Take that mask off, sir. Jesus stepped a little closer and said, it's not a mask. I've come to this hell party to tell you, death is finished. Give me the keys of death now, for I am the resurrection and the life. You may be seated for a moment. Who'd you want me to pray for? Who'd you? You brought in a wheelchair.
Yes. Oh, yes.
It's a great sister in the Lord. You're going to be all right. Sure, you're going to be all right. What's wrong with you? Edema is what? Edema.
What? Water.
Water. What does that do? I don't know what that does.
It's swelling and fluid in the body.
Yeah.
And then it was going away, and come to find out, five of the medications that they were giving me was keeping the swelling on.
So you come for prayer tonight for God to take all the swelling and to completely heal your body. What'd you say?
I believe in tithing. I'll send my tithing if I'm not tithing. It's always here. You can ask Lou. You can ask Lou. I said it by Lou.
Well, yeah.
They bring their tithing to me so that I can bring it to church.
Yes, God.
Well, it's going to be a miracle here tonight. Going to be a miracle. Singers, come help me. Going to be a miracle. Heaviness that keeps you from walking. You may be seated so the back row can see. They want to make sure that it's really somebody in the wheelchair. Because she is a believer and she gave the testimony of, Chair, I'm going to tell you something. The devil has already tried to kill her. But because the Spirit is in her, maketh intercession. Satan has to ask him, can I take her out now? But the Spirit maketh intercession for you. And God says, no way. You're going to live. And before Easter, you won't need that wheelchair no more, no more, no more, no more. What do you want me as a spiritual leader to do? To say, thank you, you're so faithful and I appreciate you. Turk, stand up with her. He had to bring her to church and he came over and he said, she wants to be anointed tonight because she wanted to come tonight. And I just want to tell you that it's going to be a big deal for your family, for doctors. But what do you want me to do as a pastor? You want me to pat her on the shoulder and say, sorry, baby, I hope you get better. I can't tell her to find the right medicine. She just told you. The five she took was hurting her. So I can't tell her find the right medicine. What do you want me to do as a pastor? What do you want me to do as a leader? Watch her suffer. No, sir, not on your dead body. You come to this church, hell will have to get through me before it gets through you. And some of you, you value your concerts, your house, your cars. You have no value, but only to those lawyers and doctors that you will pay anything to. But when there's a real man of God that will stand in faith, risk everything to believe, there's no amount of money that can touch that anointed man of God. And in fact, he's not interested in money. If I was interested in money, I'd have been gone a long time ago. Thank God for his blessings. Thank God for all over the world I've been. Thank God for all my books, and thank God for all the television I've done, raising and building TBN and Daystar and every word network. Praise God. But tonight, the devil's in big trouble. I just want to know we've had it with you, Satan. And this sister's not going down, but she's going up. And the water in her body is about to come out. And God is going to heal her. And she's going to need no wheelchair. And she's going to live to see her grandchildren and great-grandchildren. And she's going to have a Tesla. Can I get anybody to believe with me? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Spirit is making intercession. Hando robokoyo. La roboriende. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Reggie, why in the world are you and your wife shouting? You should be home crying tonight. You lost your daughter. She was 35. Went to this church. Fell over dead. Just like that. Had her funeral yesterday. Reggie and his wife will be here praising. They're on their feet. They ought to be crying and moaning, and somebody ought to have their arm around them. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? You may be seated just for a moment.
Beloved, I've been in all of it, and I thank God for being a servant here at FCC. But I want to let you know, the enemy comes to discredit God. He wants you to look at me and say, wait a minute. So she shouts, she talks, speaking tongues, and she pays her tithes. She does all this, and look at her. He wants to discourage you, but I want to let you know, no matter what I'm going through, no matter what you're going through, you hang on to the love of God. I'm telling you, because you got service to do here, or he's going to take you home where you got a great home. And this is an anointed pastor. I tell you, thank God.
Horrible, Rendo. Going to heal her feet. Is that water? Is that what that does?
There's always a way you can serve God. If you can't get to church, get on that phone and pray for somebody. There's always something to do for our Heavenly Father. He gets the glory. Sick or not sick, he gets the glory. There's nobody like him. Nobody.
So I want to tell you tonight, I'm going to do what God says. I'm going to lay my hands on her. She will be healed tonight. She said the swelling's already gone under that hand. Maybe I need to do this one more time here. Somebody believe. Somebody hold on to hope. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. Somebody say, I know she's being healed in the name of Jesus. Now, let's go to the back row back there and wake them up a little bit. Come on, somebody believe. Somebody believe up in the balcony. Somebody believe. That's so sweet. She's going to be healed. I want everybody to see this. Because when she stands with no wheelchair in a few weeks, you're going to know where she was and how she was. God. Everybody jump to your feet right now. Stretch your hands. Everybody jump to your feet. Stretch your hands. The Bible said they shall lay hands on the sick. They shall recover. In the name of Jesus, I take my hand. I lay it with the agreement of this church, that in the name of Jesus Christ, all access water leave your body. And in the next 17 days, you're going to walk with the power of the Almighty God. Be healed. I need somebody to believe that with me right now. Be healed. I curse you, devil. I rebuke you, devil. You are a liar, devil. You may be seated. Somebody get a calendar. 17 days. Get a calendar. Somebody get a calendar. Yeah, I don't know how many days or how many weeks that is, but sometime on a Wednesday night, she's going to walk without this wheelchair. I hope you're here. She's going to walk me down here. And God, I did not expect this. I didn't know this was going to happen. But God is trying to show all of you, don't give up hope. The Spirit is making intercession. It's a moment of moaning and groaning, but she's rejoicing in her infirmity. So everybody say, congratulations. You're going to walk again. Come on, prophesy. Tell her. You're going to be well. I believe God's going to, come on, speak it out. God's going to heal you. Come on, everybody. Speak it out with your mouth. Let God hear your faith. Happen. It's gonna happen. Already she said the swelling's going down in her arms. Somebody give the Lord a great big hand clap and thank him. Let's make a deal. This is on television. Everybody, let's make a deal. 17 days, mark it off. And whatever that is closest to the Wednesday night, bring her wheelchair and let her push me. And let her rejoice and say, look what the Lord has done. Anybody believe that? Shout a great big amen. God's healing. Now, you may be seated for a moment. I know some people are saying, Wonder if it don't happen, Pastor, in 17 days. It gonna make you look bad? Not at all. Because I won't be made to look bad. The Spirit's making intercession. If you're such a critical person, why don't you get up here and you push your wheelchair up here? You talk about what God's going to do. God will honor our faith. And many of you, I'm so proud of you. I saw people in the balcony just saying, she's going to be healed. And in the back, I saw you. God saw you. And every word you spoke in faith is going to come back to you. The Holy Spirit speaking to me right now. 10 times more. 10 times more to you. Meaning that if you're ever going to go through, God's going to put 10 more times the power upon your life. Well, this is a good first night for us to be back. To see God do what He's doing. Did anybody and everybody enjoy the word of the Lord tonight? Let a good sound come from your mouth. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Guess what we're going to do now? I want to hear you scream and get so excited. We're going to take an offering. The Wednesday night. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. So you can take your phones out and let, this may be your first time to tithe, maybe the first time to give. Maybe it's you're a person that always gives. Learn to give an offering. Learn to give tithing. If you got something from the Word, if you already gave your tithe Sunday, just give an offering. Just say, Lord, I appreciate the Word of the Lord. For everybody here tonight, I want to tell you, I keep hearing 17 days, and I don't know why I said that. I said Easter. That would at least give me that at least give me about 3 or 4 more weeks in case this didn't work. But I keep hearing 17, and I want to tell many people here that are watching and that are in this auditorium. I don't know everything you're going through. But there is a breakthrough on the 17th day. Count it off. Go to the calendar tonight. Count them off. Watch God show up. Watch the Spirit make intercession for you. So as we give, you can do it by envelope. If you just want to do it by check, Family Christian Center. We like to do it by envelope because I'd like to keep records to give everybody back their records. We're very organized. Listen, everybody that's new here, if you're wondering about our money and all of that stuff, let me just tell you, we've been audited 4 times. One time, 90,000 pieces of document. It's been hundreds of thousands of dollars in lawyer fees. They didn't find one thing, only to say this is a great organization and they do what they say. So we've already been tried, true. Don't have to prove anything to anybody. But as we continue to grow and expand the kingdom. If you want to give to something, you see our screens? 3 years ago, see the screens? They're brand new. They're brand new. This screen broke. You notice it couldn't go up and down. Did you know that 3 years ago, Paul was working in a Hilton convention center, I guess. And they ordered these brand new screens, $10,000 a piece. Hilton did not like them. And said to Paul, who was putting them up, get rid of them, you can have them. So he brought them to Family Christian Center.
And the funny thing is, we would have put him up 3 years ago, but Tavon, he's here tonight somewhere. I misunderstood Tavon because I thought Tavon said, they're bigger than our screens and we'd have to adjust the curtains. Then about 3 weeks ago when the screen was broke. In fact, one Sunday, if you all will recognize and know, we had to show the image on the curtain. Broke. And then Paul began to tell me, no, it's not bigger. And I said, I thought I heard Tavon say it was bigger. And when I found out that they were the exact same size, I was so excited. $20,000 worth of screens given to Family Christian Center. Come on, y'all say thank you, Lord. Now it took $6,000 to put them up. You thought you were going to have to get out of it. No. It's the work of the Lord. I won't say this on Sunday. I want to say it tonight. I only say private things on Wednesday night. A few weeks ago, a couple months ago, our fly rigs with Jesus flying out and our fly rigs for the angels, the company actually told us on the phone we're taking them down after 25 years because we make no money on you. So we are breaking our agreement. So we begin to call. We tried one flying rig, and for you that were here in Scrooge, we had a flying rig right here. And on the first service, it stuck. For you that did not know that, if you're in the first service, it stuck. We had to run everybody out of the auditorium, get ladders, and get her off of there. That didn't work. So my grandson Malachi, who's coming on as a great leader, he called all over the world. He called the UK, he called England, called every city of anybody that would fly. He said, Papa, I begin to pray because we're up against it. Jesus won't fly this year. Satan, Michael won't fly this year because nobody. And everybody said it was too close to performance and they couldn't help us. But he said, Papa, I found a company in St. Louis. And when I talked to the owner, she said, your name Malachi? He said, yes, my name is Malachi Munsey. She said, you know, that's the last book in the Old Testament. Malachi said, praise God, it's a Christian. Praise God, it's a Christian. There are worldwide flyers. So Malachi said, please come see. So they came from St. Louis. And when they stepped on this stage, you all need to know this because it's boring to a lot of you. When they stepped on this stage and saw that set, they said, we've been all over the world. We do the biggest concerts in the world. We've never seen anything like this. This is the most unbelievable thing we've ever seen in church. We don't have the rigs, but we're going to do everything we possibly can. It's going to cost us $57,000 to fly Jesus. The rigs can't go anywhere. $57,000. Oh, I know what you're saying way back there. Up there, down here. I can't believe you'd spend that much. Let me tell you something. Jesus is worth than going to the concert of Beyonce, Taylor Swift. And those are great. Beyonce, if you're watching, send your tithes, girl. And you, Taylor, you do too. Love you. Got great talent. It's a disgrace that we think that Jesus is cheap. But you go to a church that don't think Jesus is cheap. And I know that sounds like a lot of money. And I'm not asking you for a dime. I just raised the ticket price to $3. Wouldn't ask you for a dime for Jesus to fly. I wouldn't come up here and beg $1 from anybody. But God gave the gift to this house. And the need will be met. And we're going to fly Jesus in 2024. Think about all the things that we do. The 5,000 costumes we have. The horses that we spend nearly $300,000 to feed. Horseshoe, veterinarian bills. So we can have horses and sheep and donkeys for Jesus to ride. You do all of that? Yes. We take it out of the ticket money. So if you're worried about where the ticket money goes, it goes to the donkeys and the jackasses and the horses and the trailers and costumes and the fly rigs and the makeup. Why would you do that? Because if Taylor Swift can spend $2 billion on two stages. Now, you're not hearing me. And I like Taylor. I do. Some of it, not all of it. Some. And I'm glad she's dating a man, thank God. I just, Kelsey, God bless them. That's a kind of a fairy tale thing going together. Yes, I am for the Chiefs. I like Mahomes because he's filled with the Holy Ghost. So, I know the 49ers are supposed to be better, but Mahomes got the Holy Ghost. He may have some help there. He is. He's a tongue-talking Holy Ghost boy. He goes to one of my friends' church in Kansas City. $2 billion. Each stage she performs on costs $1 billion. While she's performing on one stage, they're setting up another stage in another country. When she dropped through the stage, there's a golf cart waiting. That's how big the stage is. And she drives to the other end of the stage, underneath the stage in a golf cart, to do her thing. And people spend $1,000 for tickets, $500 for tickets. Don't you even get near me. When you look at the ticket price for Jesus and the price that he paid to die for you and I, you should buy 100 of them and give them away. And I will do anything and everything. You can go to another church. We love you. We need your seat anyway. You can go play party and clicks. But here, we're going to lift up Jesus. And we're going to lift up that cross. We're going to let the world know. Let me tell you something, folks, in the closing moments. I'm going to tell you something. Nobody understands really what is going to happen, but the Lord gave me a vision. If the Lord tarries 50 years from now, I'll be gone, probably go to heaven, Melody. You surely don't want me around at 120. I'm going to tell you something. This stage will become world famous. I'm going to give you the new plans Easter Sunday morning of the new front and the east side. That cross and that new lobby and all the new bathrooms and the east side. And we open up the balcony on these up here. Mark it down. Anybody who's ever supported this ministry, your name will be listed in the new part. 50 to 60 years from now, people won't be going to Notre Dame in Paris to look at that. They'll be coming right here. Saying, I heard about that set. I heard about the beauty of that place. So not this year only, but yeah, this year I'm expanding it. Wait till you see what I'm doing. I'm doing a whole new thing. You'll have to come see it. Soon Calvary will expand to the other part of the building, so will the tomb. It will all be friendly for tourists. Because one day, I don't know how many years from now, people will be lining up in the lobby saying, can I walk through? Like they do at Notre Dame in Paris, but they only look at pictures. They'll get to walk to Calvary, to a tomb. Majestic thing that we are part of, that nobody that we know of, and we're not trying to be the only ones, but there's not another church in America or in the world that we know of that has a permanent set of Jerusalem. Look at us. Look what God has done for us. Are you ready to lift him up? Shout a great big amen. Ushers, go through real quick. As soon as the offering container passes you, just stand to your feet. I'm going to bless you, sing a little bit as the offering is taken right now all over the building. Stretch your hands toward the offering. I too want to give. Say, God, we are so happy.
We are so happy.
We can be obedient.
We can be obedient.
And God, the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit
is interceding.
Is interceding.
On my behalf.
On my behalf.
Meaning. All things
are
going to work out for the good.
What I'm going through now,
it's all going to work out
for the good.
Everyone be healed, be blessed. Sunday morning, both services, I got something that's going to blow your mind. I'll be speaking, you won't want to miss it. You guys go out that way. Turn to somebody and say, God is good. God bless you. Sing this out.
I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered.
I believe that that word on this Wednesday night was for you. I pray, I agree. I'm in strong agreement, as well as the congregation. We are in agreement with one another. That word will be incubated in our spirits, and that we will see the manifestations of God's miracles through your doctor, through your banker, through your relations, on your job, in your health. You're going to wake up in the morning, and there's going to be a brighter, there's going to be a bigger, and there's going to be a wonderful opportunity. I believe that. I want to excite you because 3 weeks from tonight, we've ended this Wednesday night, so 2 Wednesday nights from now is Ash Wednesday. February 14th is Ash Wednesday. That is the beginning of 50 days until Easter. It is our culture at Family Christian Center to lift up the cross. And we are going to let the cross down for the first time. And on Ash Wednesday, we will begin to put our request. You can now
you know, you can email your request in advance so that we can begin to collect them, to put them on the cross 3 weeks from tonight. And I want to excite you that I believe that this year is going to be just incredible as we let the cross down every Wednesday night. On Ash Wednesday night, every person, there will be oil applied to them for the anointing that will be on them this year and the next 50 days. And what we are going to experience by resurrection Easter Sunday, it just is going to be so unbelievable. May I say to you and to everyone, we've already been in rehearsals. Jesus of Nazareth will be the first weekend of March. Now, March 2nd will be our premiere. Get your tickets now because this is the 50th year, it is spreading and people are coming. People are coming to rejoice with us and to celebrate our 50th year. Some are coming that have never experienced seeing it before. Some have come on a regular base, never missed a year. And there's some that have come in the past that says, I want to come and celebrate. They've lifted up the cross. FCC has lifted up the cross. Doing Jesus of Nazareth for 50 years. I might say there are some big surprises. It is different. Within the story, within the stage production that you have witnessed, if you have witnessed it, it is different. You will see some things that you will say, and it will startle you with the set, with the story, the presentation of Jesus of Nazareth that I wrote 50 years ago this Easter. Watching it develop and watching it, over 1,000 participants are involved. Get your tickets today. Get people to come. And the very first weekend is March, and we do it every weekend up till Easter. But Easter is in March. It's early. It's not in April. It's early. That means just weeks away from opening Jesus of Nazareth. There's only 4 weeks in February, so remember, it starts the first week of March. You're just weeks away, days away, as we are preparing for Jesus of Nazareth. Get your tickets. Also, I want to say Super Bowl Sunday is going to be great. You don't want to miss that because there's going to be some extraordinary things that are going to happen on Super Bowl Sunday. I am so excited about what God is doing, and I pray. I have been praying. I have been believing what God is going to do through you, for you, and upon you is this season. Your miracle, your believing, your dream, what you have been saying in your prayers is going to come to pass. This is going to be an anointed season. 50 years we've been lifting up the cross, and I want to excite everybody. This Sunday, I will be speaking on something that I just can't wait for you to hear the word. This Sunday is going to be so incredible. You don't want to miss it. Of course, this Friday, I'll be praying. I hope you join me in prayer at 6:00 in the morning. And pray for us as we lift up Jesus of Nazareth. Get your prayer request in and get ready for the cross to come down in 2 weeks as that on Ash Wednesday we start nailing your request, your prayer request upon the cross. Until next time and until Sunday to see you again, just want to tell you, yes, you can.